Okay, in this video, I'm going to look at the introduction section and how it's organized. The introduction is the first major section of your paper. Now, there are five things that the introduction should do. First, it should get the reader's attention and interest. Second, it should give the reader a summary of previous research, what is already known about the topic. Next, it should set up your research by formulating a clear problem to be solved. That's what we don't yet know about the problem. Four, you should propose a hypothesis to test with your experiment. And then five, you should state the main purpose of your study. Now, let's have a look at a couple introductions from real research papers and see what they have. Introductions can be a bit different depending on the topic, so we're going to compare two examples. Okay, first, here is a study that examines the effect of different chemicals on preventing the browning of apple slices. And here's the introduction. First, it starts with some facts about preserving fruit that shows us why this topic is important. And then it introduces the topic of browning, right here. Okay, and then it introduces the problem that we need to solve, that a replacement technique for preventing fruit from browning has urgently been sought. Next, it reviews previous research that shows what kind of chemicals prevent browning. Okay, now we get to the problem that this paper is going to address, okay, right here, that most of the reported activities are measured individually at different conditions. Okay, and right here, this is the main problem that this study is going to try to address. The overall relative inhibitory activity of individual compounds is not clear. And then we have the main purpose of the study here. The main purpose of the study was to find the most effective anti-browning agents for apple slices by comparing the anti-browning activity of commonly known compounds under the same conditions. So we started by getting the reader's attention and then reviewing the history of the problem and what is known about the problem. Then we get into the what we don't know. And then finally, they have the statement of the purpose of this research. Now you notice this introduction does not have a hypothesis because they don't really know which chemical is going to stop browning the most. They just have a lot of evidence that different chemicals do, and they're going to compare them. So depending on the study, sometimes you won't be able to state a hypothesis. That's why introductions are sometimes different. Okay. Next, let's look at this paper about referees being the reason that athletes who wear red win more. Now, in this case, the introduction starts directly with background information about the research, about previous research. So it doesn't have anything to get the reader's attention like the Apple paper did. And this whole first paragraph is reviewing what we already know about wearing red sports attire has a positive impact. And what are the reasons that other people have suggested that this happens? Okay, so that's the review of of what we already know. Then we get to this part. We disagree with both interpretations. This is kind of the hypothesis of the paper, but it's also explaining the problem. It's explaining that they don't think that these reasons are true. After that, they explain the reasoning behind it. Why do they think this hypothesis is true? Okay, and then finally, they come again to repeating the hypothesis right here. Therefore, we believe that it is the referees who are the actual cause of the advantage competitors have when they wear red. And then finally, just like the other paper, the last thing in your introduction should be your statement of purpose. Because the effect of red clothing on performance and on the decisions of referees may well have been confounded in the original data, we conducted a new experiment and found. Okay, now one more thing that I want to talk about is citations. Okay, what are citations? Well, citations are these things and these things here. An example is this sentence. Okay, referees and umpires exert a major influence on the outcome of sports competitions. That information They cite this paper, Plessner and Haar 2006, to as evidence that this statement is true. This is very important in your research paper. You can't write from your head. You need to back up everything you say with evidence, and that evidence either comes from a logical argument, or it comes from your own experiment, or it comes from previous research papers. Everything needs to be backed up with evidence. Now, it might seem reasonable referees and umpires exert a major influence on the outcome of sports competitions, but without the reference, that's just your opinion, and your scientific paper needs to be 100% justified so that other people will believe what you write. Now, if we want to know what this paper is, we can go to the list of references at the end of the paper, and here is all the details. You have the names of the authors, the year, the name of the paper, the name of the journal that it comes from, the volume number, the pages, okay? And your research paper will also have to have a reference list at the end, like this. You can use the book that I gave you in class, this one, to find out how to do these references. And also, I have another video that explains how to do this in Word. Okay, let's just go back here for a second. Two ways you can put citations in your paper. One is to say the point and then put this at the end in parentheses. Family names of the authors and the year. The other way is if you use the names of the researchers in the sentence, like this. Hill and Barton showed that wearing red sports attire, okay, then in this case, you just put the year in parentheses after the name. Okay, one last point about citations. As I said, don't write from your head. For example, you might know from maybe a high school science class, or maybe you saw something on TV, you might know that honey can be used to prevent apple slices from turning brown. But just because you know that, you can't write it in your paper. You need to find a trustworthy source of information to be evidence for your statement that honey can stop apples from turning brown. Okay, so in your introduction, you're going to be doing a lot of summarizing sources. A couple other things to note, don't copy from your sources. This is considered plagiarism and will get you in big trouble. Okay, don't copy more than, let's say, 3 words in a row. You have to change what's written in the sources into your own words, your own way to explain it. Next, don't quote from your sources. Don't use quotation marks. Just explain what the sources say in your own words. And lastly, this is the third time I've said this now, summarize in your own words. A good technique for doing this is read your source, read the research paper, and make sure you understand it. Keep reading it until you understand it. Then close the book or put the paper away and write notes. Then, when you write your paper, use your notes instead of looking at the original research paper when you're writing. Okay, so just to review, when you're writing the introduction, you want to start by getting the reader's attention. You want to organize it properly with a summary of previous research, the problem to solve, your hypothesis, and your statement of purpose. And you want to back up your statements with citations. Don't write from your head, summarize your sources, don't copy or quote, and format your citations and reference list correctly.